posted on the corner. I'm posted on the corner.
Posting on the corner with yours truly, Incognito
and DJ Misses.
DJ Misses.
Yes, Sirski.
Grammy Award winning.
Come on.
Rapper.
Come on.
Actor.
Philanthropist.
Husband.
Come on.
Father.
All around real one.
Songwriter.
Come on.
Killer Mike in the studio.
Come on, man. I'm going to have y'all do my introduction to my wife. She don't know how bad a man I am, man.
Man, we got Killer Kill from the Ville posted on the corner.
Legendary. Oh, come on now.
The new project, Michael, is available now on all digital streaming platforms.
Yep, and physical is coming in September. You'll be able to get the CDs from DBS Sounds, Criminal Records. You'll be able to get the records and order the vinyl. You can't, to me, if you can't hold it, you don't really own it. So
yeah.
I like the physical still.
Yeah.
That's cool, because we were just talking about that. Like, when the last time you was like, I need to go buy a CD?
Yeah, man. Hope I inspired that.
Come on.
A lot of old heads. I could tell who got an old school or who an old head when they hit me up on social media. I'm like, Kill, where I can get the CD from? I'm like, yeah, he drive the 72 Cutlass and he was born in 72.
Yeah. Now
I'm
going through that book on that
thing. Come on now.
I see it.
I know this part.
That's the one. We got Killer Mike here. The latest project, Michael, is available. When it came to getting the title for this album, how did you land on Michael? Was that the one that just
I just had never introduced people to me. Mm. You know, Killer Mike is a rap name I won in a battle when I was like 15, 16, but just wanting to be a bad, trash-talking, you know, swaggering MC, the nine-year-old boy that's on the cover, that's just something he invented.
Mm.
And that's the power of a child's imagination. Like, I imagined all this before it happened. But I realized I'd really been around, you know, had been around 16, 17 years, have a decade of being one half of one of the greatest rap duos in Run the Jewels. And nobody had ever just met Michael. So if Run the Jewels is like the X-Men, Killer Mike is like Wolverine, Michael is like Logan. Let you know what really gave you the makings of the character you love is Killer Mike. You know?
So why was it so important for you to put this out? And why did it take so long?
Well, folks started dying. I came home, we shot, Run the Jewels shot Ooh La La, and you know, we got massive response from that. For people who may not know, I've been in a group the last decade called Run the Jewels. And we're a rap act, but we kind of get treated like a rock act. We play Shaky Knees Festival here. You know, we play a lot of the big festivals. We open for Rage Against the Machine. Tour with them. Just a lot of cool stuff has happened over the last decade. But I hadn't really gave, if you were from Atlanta, you knew Michael. A lot of people just didn't know. I came home and caught COVID before they even gave it a name. I thought I was going to die. Thank God I convinced my wife to drop out of nursing school 20 years ago because, man, she really nursed me back. So when I bounced back, I was like, boy, it could have been over, big dog. Yeah. And I was like, you know, I had a bunch of records I had kind of just freestyle worked on. One on was the opening Down by Law. If you hear me, rest in peace to Matulu Shakur, who we lost a few days ago. I say Obama, you know, I asked him to free Asada and free Matulu. So that record started getting freestyled the year Obama was leaving office.
Mm-hmm.
That's how long we've been. I'm just like, I can't just keep sitting on art. I recorded about 39 records, and we trimmed them down. We went out to L.A. after about a year, year and a half recording with No ID, who executive produced the record, and we trimmed it on down. While I was out in L.A., I let Dre 3000 hit a record. Dre heard it and called me the next day like, hey, can I bring some records through?
Ooh.
And next thing you know, he brought something through that ended up being Scientists and Engineers, me, him, and Future. You know, Black came through the studio, just listened to the record. He came back and sent something back that was crazy. You know, Currency and 2 Chainz, they're my partners. They're like my D-Boy partners. So I sent them something. They sent it right back. Blast came through the studio, and then he came back the next day, laid something on it. Aaron Allen Kane, who sang all over the album.
Ooh.
She was in the studio just hanging out with us. Lena Bird, Miles sent something in. So, man, all the people I work with, it just came out of these organic relationships where I was just say, hey, check the record out. Ty Dolla came and heard the record and said, send me these two records and sent the records back. So it's been a blessing, man. You got to, you know, be careful what you ask for. As a 9-year-old kid, I wanted to be a rapper, and God has made a path for me to do it. Mm-hmm. But all along the way, I've had challenges. People challenge me to be smarter. People challenge me to do better. You know, I learned how to fly planes because my 4th-grade teacher said, you're too smart to be a rapper. You ought to be an airplane pilot.
Mm.
So at 15, I went to pilot school with Slim from 112. We learned how to fly planes because the teacher challenged us to, you know.
Right.
So for me, man, I just want to tell kids on your journey out there, you know, believe in yourself. Believe, like, even if you're 12 or 13, you just start kind of seeing the world for what it really is. think back when you was 8 or 9 and nothing seemed impossible. You got to dream and think that big, mm-hmm. and that is going to certainly bring you there, but you got to accept the journey you go on.
Yes, sir.
Because my journey is a 20-year journey. I woke up, my wife, the day the album dropped, she said, well, happy Resurrection Day.
Cause you, hello.
You know, she said, you're a new artist now.
Yeah.
You know, these kids don't know nothing about what you're doing to them. They know what they feel today, and that's definitely been true. Because I woke up, Damani Tipson, who I see like a real nephew. I love that kid. He's one of the hardest working young artists in the business. Mm-hmm. And he said, Killer Mike album's the only album I can listen to all day.
Wow.
Like, he ain't got to be interested in no. This is me and his dad. I'm his dad's contemporary. So that lets me know that I'm doing something that strikes people my age and older and strikes people even younger, because it's just, you know, it's art, it's truth, it's just compelling, it's make you feel something.
Yeah, that is amazing that fourth grade teacher told you that smart people fly planes. I don't know if that teacher knew you was born on 420, so you're going to be high anyway.
Anyway.
Then Slim from 112 done made the song So Fly.
Yeah.
Well, that came all the way together.
It came together, man.
When it came to these 39 tracks, what was the first record you recorded for the Project Michael?
I say the first record was the first one, the Down by Law record you hear. Because that was a freestyle. Again, I started it when Obama was leaving office.
Right.
You know, when I say, please see our mama, please free Assad, that's begging him, like, at the end of his presidency, take all these people off the list. Mm. Free Leonard Peltier, you know, free Assad Shakur, free Mutulu Shakur, who did get free on a compassionate release before he died, God bless the dead.
Mm-hmm.
But yeah, that's how long. That was the first record.
Mm.
And after that, just different things, different emotions, like Something for Junkies was a record I had in my heart a long time, because as, you know, the drug craze of the 80s and 90s and even now, it takes a lot of our family members, people we love. It turns our feelings cold to them. And they just everyday people. They just, most of them, deeply sensitive people that can't handle the perils of the real world. So I wanted to, for us from the rap side, to give each other some grace and some mm-hmm. empathy, you know? So that's sure. That's why. But, you know, the last record I recorded was Motherless, because I had never really dealt with my mother and grandmother passing. You know, mm-hmm. I say passing, a transition, a gone, but they dead, you
right.
know, and it took a lot for me. I remember in the booth, the first time I'd ever said it. I said the first word, my mama dead, my grandmama dead, and I started crying and rapping it.
Yeah.
You know, a verse and a half later, I flew back to Atlanta, finished the song, went back out to LA, and we got it right, you know.
Mm-hmm. I definitely feel like this was an album that my generation for sure needed to hear,
yeah.
because we don't see a lot of our OGs talk about their feelings and what they've been through
yeah.
and what they stand for, actually standing on it.
Yeah.
And I do want to say Motherless was a very beautiful song. We thank you for being so vulnerable with us, because you didn't have to let us into that.
Yeah, thank you.
That so moment. So I know that probably had to been one of the most difficult parts
yeah,
of the album.
It wasn't easy. Mm-hmm. But, you know, not a lot of young people younger than me have lost their mother. I know it's not easy mm-hmm. for them, you know, and I just want to say to people, you know, who have, man, it's a hard club to be a part of, but you're not alone.
For sure.
You know, and to the people that still have mothers, if you don't see eye to eye, you know, still just give each other some grace. Because, man, you know, my mama told me, she said, one day I'm going to be gone, Michael, you're going to see
mm-hmm.
that my mama wanted you, but you belong to me.
Come on.
And you don't understand the sacrifice that took from me.
Right.
And, boy, she was right. The moment she left, boy, I get chill bumps thinking about it now. She mm-hmm. was right. She was. There was a story of Solomon, who's a wise king in the Bible. And two women come before him with a baby, and each of the women say, this is my baby. And he say, well, cut the baby in half, give each other half of the baby. And the real mother says, no, let my child stay with the other. I don't want my child to die. Mm-hmm. And I didn't understand the sacrifice my mother did when giving me to my grandmother, because my grandmother wanted me.
Mm-hmm.
You know, I wasn't left with nobody. I wasn't, no, you know, I wasn't tossed aside. My grandmother asked to raise me, you know, and my mother had to wherewithal to understand that she's better with her,
mm-hmm.
you know. So you know, now she's gone. I can't tell her. I can't do nothing but pray to an altar, you know, offer some libations and, you know, just hope she hear me on the other side.
For sure. So what was the easiest part about making this album?
Oh, man, having fun.
Yeah.
Oh, man, this record was fun all the way through, man. Because we worked the third shift. Because Lightyear, he A&R'd the record. He artist mm-hmm. himself, but put his career on pause, A&R the record. Because, man, it was me and Cuz every night, like third shift at the factory. He had just had my godson, my little nephew, Bricks. So his girl's dental hygienist, so she was working during the day. So he'll have Bricks in the day. Then at 10 at night, we started at No Face, No Case Studios in Stankonia, and then we ended up at Supersounds, the Tip Studio.
Mm-hmm.
10 at night, we'll report like we was going to UPS, and we'd been there at 4 or 5 in the morning. Mm-hmm. You know what I'm saying? And it was just him, Honorable C-No to come through.
Yeah.
C-No to talk about one line he didn't like. Me and him would get to arguing over the line. You know what I'm saying? So it was just fun, because to be honest, I didn't have to ask a label. I recorded out of my pocket. Well, that wasn't fun. My wife found out how much money I spent. After I got about $250,000 in, she was like, what you doing? Like,
okay, now.
Yeah, you know. we spent about $500,000 of my own money, but yeah. It was worth it. It was just, man, it was fun. I didn't have no expectations. All I wanted to do was make the dopest possible album I could, and I wanted to make an album that felt familiar. I wanted to make an album that felt like it celebrated masculinity, celebrated black masculinity, and celebrated men and the women who love them. It's a lot of talk about women on this record, whether it's my grandmother, my mother, my children's mothers, you know what I'm saying? Women I've encountered that affected my life beautifully. It's a very salt of the earth record, you know?
Sure.
Killer Kill from the Ville is here. Posted on the corner with yours truly, Incognito and DJ Misses. Let's go back to Dickies and Trucks.
Come on.
You know? let's talk about your favorite verse on this project. What was your favorite verse?
Man, I got a lot of favorite verses. It depends on the mood. You know what I'm saying? Mm-hmm. But the one I'm still trying to get all the way was a tongue twister. That's Scientists and Engineers, man.
Yeah.
Oh, man. That's one, man.
Yeah.
That's one. Just get it. It's this white girl on TikTok that's already got it better than me. I'm like, man.
You know, TikTok, once they get a hold of something, they ain't going to let it go.
But the Scientists and Engineers. So y'all call and request it, man. I want that song played up here. I think it's a dope record. It's me, Future, Dre. I think that one. And I'm going to say, too, man, one of my favorite records, too. I was glad to see a lot of people who cruise, like, they like that Spaceship Views with me, Currency, and Tick, you know, Two Chai.
That's the vibe.
That's your one. That's the vibe. Yeah, that one.
That's the vibe. So how do you feel? Because music changes so much over time. So how do you feel about the current state of music right now?
I like it all. I'm an artist. You know what I mean? So I be with it. What I love about the Atlanta music scene is, it's ironic that our city's logo is a phoenix, because that's a bird that burns itself in the ashes, then arises anew out the ashes.
Mm-hmm.
When you look at Atlanta from 2000 to now, the styles have changed 8, 9, 10 times.
Changed.
You had the rock star movement, you had the lean with it, stout with the movement, you had all these different movements that come, but it's just an evolution. It's a step up, you know what I mean? So, or it's a step in another direction. So I'm never displeased with the music. I'm displeased with like stupid arguments over, you know, because the same trash that gets talked about the music today got talked about the music when we listen to it too. But my thing is, I was talking to George Clinton once, and he says when he feel himself hating on something, usually he know that and that's when it, because he's like, that's his old man kicking in, and he had to get with his grandkids and stuff to kind of shake that. And I was like, so it's good. You get locked into what you're comfortable with. But I think with Michael, what I did was make timeless music. I made the music that feels like the gospel your grandmother would play, feels like the soul, the cleanup music your mom would play. It feels like the groovy music that you like to cruise to. I think I broke the matrix. Good music breaks the matrix. I could play Prince, I could play Michael Jackson, I could play Rick James, I could play all that to my 3-year-old.
Yes, sir.
And they gonna move and groove. I could play the Eagles, I could play the Bee Gees, I could play Michael McDonald, and they gonna move. That's why at the beginning of the show, that my DJ plays this playlist my mom played, and they got everything in it from Donna Summer to Teddy Pendergrass. Like,
that's dope.
So what I focus on is I want to make music that feels timeless, you know what I mean? That feels like it could be played in any era, you know? Because it's a vibe, you know? And black folks got cool vibes, man.
Come on now.
You know?
What was the first record that you heard to make you resonate with music, hip-hop, that you fell in love with? You heard that song, you was like, man, I got that in me.
Oh, man.
Life is all about harmony. Those notes are created by the people you meet and those you love, by your origins, your roots, the place you come from, your home. I mean, it's in every small detail. It's in what you see, you hear, or just what you feel. Each note is different, unique, and it has its own vibe. And when it comes together, it creates an energy. It draws a journey, like Remy Martin. These notes write your story.
With hip hop, at first, my mom's only 16 years older than me, so hip hop at first was her music. It was like Curtis Blow, you know, Houdini. It was like grown folks, like dressed kind of disco-y, you know what I'm saying? But Man, when I heard the Fat Boys and Run DMC, the Fat Boys, because they was fat, I was like, oh, yeah. I was like, man, they rapping. I was like, I could get a Gucci.
Come on.
I'm like, oh, yeah, I got to do all this.
Come on.
Man, but when I heard Run DMC, man, oh, my God, man.
It changed
the game for me. And that was like the 8-9-year-old me, like, oh, you could do this. But, like, who I seen, when I seen Ice Cube, a lot of people hear me, they like my voice inflects like Ice Cube lyrically. Mm. You know, when you hear me, like Ice Cube and Scarface in particular was such big influences on me. Like Scarface for the morality and depth that he wrote with Ice Cube, for just like the emotion and anger. Like I saw someone say that they didn't consider Ice Cube a civil rights leader. And I just looked at her, you know, because you have someone on those Twitter righteous people.
Yeah.
And I was like, what a cuck. You know what I mean? Like I'm like, this man wrote F the Police. This man wrote songs during when a child had got killed by a Korean store owner, wrote mm-hmm. Black Korea. He wrote Once Upon a Time in the Projects. Like, he wrote songs that acknowledged the daily life of working class black people, mm-hmm. that protested against the state oppressing black people, and as a young black person gave us the courage to research who we are. Because at the same time I'm listening to him, I'm reading the autobiography of Malcolm X, I'm seeing him play in movies where he plays a revolutionary. And who would have known about gentrification had you not watched Boys in the Hood and watched that famous speech that you know, yep. Lawrence Fishburne gave you? So for me, for her to even say that was disingenuous and classist, you know mm-hmm. what I mean? Because you're following the talented 10th rule that somehow to be a civil rights leader, you have to go through some formal accreditation. Stokely Carmichael didn't go through any formal accreditation. He was a student that wanted to get active. So he helped be a part of SNCC. Same thing John Lewis was before he went over to SCLC. But the people who often say this don't know what the hell they're talking about, because right. they're not real students of people of the movement. I'm exactly. an actual student of people in the movement. I don't know of John Lewis. I knew John Lewis. Mm-hmm. I didn't know of James Orange. I was mentored by James Orange. I haven't heard of Andy Young. Andy Young is my mentor and friend. So be responsible with your criticisms, because Ice Cube, in my opinion, not only is one of the dopest MCs, but one of the dopest political thinking leaders mm-hmm. that I've ever seen in terms of the helping the maturation of me and who I've grown into. And I know I'm bad.
I know that's yeah. right. So, Erin Allen, you had her all up and through
yeah.
this album, and that girl is a singer. She definitely brought
Detroit, baby.
That's a Detroit song. She definitely brought that gospel to it. So, how did you link up with her? How did y'all get together for those songs?
Funny thing is, Hannibal Buress, who's a friend of mine, who's a comedian. Hannibal's one of the funniest guys I know. Hannibal was a rapper first. I was like, he was a rapper. He's like, yeah, I used to host hip hop events, had a dress. And I'm just like, what? I had bought a property off of him. Mm-hmm. And, you know, he was a homie, but we never stopped talking. But after I had brought the property, I was like, I'm going to L.A. I'm going to be out there. Just come out. He came out and hung out. And we needed a voice for this. And he said, I'm going to bring my girl Erin through. And he brought her through. I didn't know at the time, Dion, no idea, apparently co-managers are two. Mm-hmm. But I heard her sing. It was over. I just kept calling her back. Hey, you check this record out? You check this? So she ended up on 5 records.
Ah, yeah. That's amazing. Yeah. But it's organic, though. You can tell
really
everything
really
about
is.
That album is organic.
It's all
down
it's
to
everything.
The features.
Yeah, we didn't do nothing but what God told us to. Everybody was just kind of in an open place. Like, what you could do, you did. And what you couldn't do, people said, well, I don't know how to do that. And somebody else will step up and say, okay, I think I got it. And that's what was beautiful about this record.
Yeah.
It really is a team effort.
For sure.
If you had a mood or a track to describe your mood today off of the project, what would you say? What song you on?
What's your song? High and Holy right
Come
now.
On,
oh,
high
yes, sir.
Holy.
That's my word right there. Speaking of High and Holy, that's the name on the tour. You're on the road.
That's the name of the tour, yeah, with the Midnight Revival. DJ Track starting the Midnight Revival.
Come on.
What is it like watching you on that stage?
Oh, right. Man, it's like you know how, man, your mama might get you in the middle of the week talking about you, we going to revival, you going to this tent in the middle of the night. Like, we got to go to revival. But you like, man, at least I can wear my jogging suit. I ain't got to wear no suit.
Yeah. Right.
You get there, your buddy be there, right. His mama be there, pretty girl you like from school there. You like, oh, man. And the music come, and it's just that. It's a revival. Like, people need to be motivated and feel loved and vibrated high, and that's what you get. You know, you coming out of our shows, man, you vibrate high. You know somebody next to you done had a week, and you might have had a week, but y'all done got through the week, and y'all finna get together, drink, smoke something, have some fun, and get some positive energy. You know, I never read of Jesus being in a church except for when he was kicking stuff over, saying don't make the church a stove. He was in the streets.
Yeah.
So we bring church to the street.
Yeah.
That's so fire. So what else can your fans expect? Are we going to expect some special guests coming out?
Man, if y'all coming out to Tabernacle tomorrow, I'll suggest if you want to, man, wear white. Mm. Wear white is vibe. We gonna have white on stage. I love for the whole audience to be whited out. So, but that's man, dope. I expect an hour 10, an hour 20 of just a roof raising good time, man. From the minute I step on stage to the minute we step off, you're gonna have a good time. This is not a traditional rap show, man. You're gonna have an experience, you know?
That's dope. So you've accomplished so much in your lifetime, but I gotta ask you, do you have any other dreams that you wanna accomplish?
Yeah, this is a reset. I got 10 more years to do.
This is
the first of three. There's gonna be three Michaels as an album. Run the Jewels 5 is something I want to get accomplished. I want to tour more. I want to be on television more, not less. And want me and my wife to grow our businesses. We got Bankhead Seafood, which I'm in partnership with T.I. We got that opening in a few months over on Bankhead, over in the Grove Park community. We got the Swag Shop, which we're about to grow. We're about to roll out about two or three more shops. We got the one at State Farm Arena. So shouts out to the Hawks, of course. One down on Edgewood and Roosevelt Highway. Man, I'm just trying to grow. Just trying to master my craft, master my art. Master being a better man and master business.
That's dope. So you bought a banking platform.
Yeah, well, a fintech company. I helped found. Yeah.
So could you tell us more about that?
Yep. Yeah, it's called Greenwood. And it was Paul Judge, my man Ryan, Bo Young, Andy Young, me. It is very hard to save money or be efficient with money when you're not financially literate and you don't have banks near you and you have check cash in places, things like that. So it just started as a fintech company to help people kind of just bank off their phones. We got about 100,000 accounts open. People seem to be satisfied with it. I tell people, you don't have to go take all your money out your big bank, right? You still have your big bank. But let this be your savings. Let this be your bill pay, things of that nature. In the same way that black banks are for us. I've been with Citizens Trust Bank. It's a 100-year-old black bank here since I was 5 years old. I always kept my retirement there. I always kept my Christmas stuff there. And then when I got to move around the country and the world, I still have a big banking account. So really just helping black people have other tools in which to bank with, especially when it comes to young people that are coming out of high school, first years of college, might be you know, poor, working poor. You need something that's not going to gouge you. So I encourage you guys to hit Greenwood.com, check them out. They have a lot of cool stuff that in terms of promoting financial literacy, like blogs and stuff you can put up. So I just think that, you know, don't be afraid to learn. You know, don't Come be on. Afraid to handle your coin. Don't be afraid to save and try to do better. Like, you know, people say, well, how can you save? I was talking to my nephew. He's 22 years old. I was like, at your age, me, your father, and two or three of our friends all had an apartment together. The ones who could pay the most had a bedroom. Those of us who could pay the least, we slept on the floor in the living room. But everybody was able to save money that way. You know what I'm saying? Because if you do that, if you look at me and three of your family members, or three of your family members got apartments in a complex, right? Y'all giving an apartment complex $6,000 a month.
Right.
Y'all could move in an apartment together and everybody save $1,000 a month. That's $12,000 you can save a year, and each of your family members could save, and that'll put you on the path to home ownership. But you got to make a sacrifice. Yes, you got to be willing to you know, be the one to sleep in on the floor. Yes, you know what I'm saying? Right. I was the one that slept on the floor. I didn't want the bigger bedroom because I knew I wasn't going to be that long. Mm-hmm. You know what I mean? So you got to think about that to because there's always a way to escape it. There's always a way to better education further. In Atlanta, nothing shows you like that, like Atlanta, man. Most of us come to Atlanta, we ain't got nothing but whatever we got in our pocket and a pillowcase.
Hello.
You know, but we make it.
Hello.
You know, we make it.
We're celebrating 50 years of hip hop. Killer Mike is here, and you gave us just a rundown of different genres of hip hop from Atlanta. But let's talk about that crump movement, bro.
Oh, that crump.
What's your biggest memory from, like, when you was out performing, Never Scared, or what that session was like? Take me there, bro.
I mean, man, Never Scared has been crazy. I'm going to tell you, though, one of the biggest moments in crump. Hurricane Katrina had happened. People were being displaced. It was horrible. They were trying to get people out of New Orleans into Houston, into Atlanta, wherever they could. And David Banner put on one of the most incredible concerts to help people. The proceeds went to help people that I've ever seen. And getting an opportunity to jump out on that stage and do Never Scared there, because black people couldn't be scared there. We couldn't wait on the government to save us. We knew one other group of people coming to save us. And Banner put this together. Banner has always been an amazing producer, an amazing rapper, but what he is an amazing organizer and motivator of his kin. Me, him, and Tip have had a special man, just like brotherhood, for years. But being a part of that was one of the biggest, best movements in crunk. And I had some amazing movements in crunk. I'm talking about about the bounce, you know, performing next to Troy. You know, I'm talking about, man, taking it all throughout the Southeast, some of the biggest shows and concerts, Daytona, BT, Weekend, that type of stuff. But that David Banner concert to help New Orleans was absolutely one of my favorite memories of doing that song and being involved in the Crunk movement.
Yes, sir. Kryptonite.
Kryptonite, man. Shouts out to Rock D, man. Rock D the legend. Purple Ribbon All-Star. We just lost Nate of Concrete Cobblers today, but Rock D the legend, a.k.a. Mr. Kryptonite, brought that song in and said, man, I got a hit record. And he called it. My budget was drained, so I didn't have no money to buy it, unfortunately. But Big figured it out and put it on the Purple Ribbons. Him and Bear got it on the Purple Ribbon All-Star soundtrack. And, man, we ain't looked back. It's one of my favorite records to perform. And look forward to Rock D popping out with me tomorrow. You know, if God willing, if he messing with me, we're going to come out tomorrow. We're going to do that.
That's dope. So if you could change one thing about the industry, what would you change?
I don't know what I'd change about the industry. What I'd change is, you know, that's not true. What I would have changed about Atlanta, I don't know about the industry, is I would have had L.A. Reid stay and LaFace Records stay.
Mm.
We for us to give this industry so much by way of talent, that's why I love and I cheer for Coach and P, what they did with QC Records.
Mm-hmm.
For us to have given so much, we should have the power, greater power to sign people. There should be greater check signing power, not just resigned to New York and Los Angeles, mm-hmm. you know. But I would keep that. There was a level of integrity that came when you had the production companies that were empowered. So Def, LaFace Records, Rockefeller Records, mm-hmm. you know, Rap-A-Lot Records at its prime, you know, Ruthless Records, Uncle Luke and Luke Skywalker Records. There was just a certain integrity in terms of what could be done and what could be done that I miss. But mm-hmm. but you know, things grow and change, so I don't right. complain. But I do miss when we had those executives leading the culture versus people who are not from the culture.
Mm, yeah. For sure. So what advice do you have for the young community that, you know, wants to help their community but don't know where to start, don't know how to figure it out? What
man,
advice do you
walk
have
walk outside
them?
On the porch, look to your left and look to your right, and that's where you start.
Mm.
Them 10 houses to your left and right is where you start. If your streets are dirty, then stop complaining to the city, or while you complain to the city, clean up.
Mm-hmm.
While you complain, tell the neighbors, hey, on Saturday we're going to come out from 12 to 2. We're going to do a cleanup. You know, after that cleanup, we'll make sure everybody bring a little something. We'll do a potluck, and we're going to eat together, break bread together. But I'm not telling you what I'm thinking of. I'm telling you what I've done.
Mm-hmm.
This is what my grandmother did. You know,
yeah.
My grandmother didn't, you know, we didn't even live in Perry Homes. One of my aunts lived in Perry Homes. We lived on Collier Drive in Collier Heights, and we'd go to Perry Homes. My grandma didn't wait for the city to come do right. She'd clean up around my aunt's house and get the neighbors to do it. So my thing is nothing like self-organization. You know, Stokely Carmichael, Kwame Ture talked about that black mm-hmm. people need to be in a constant state of organizing.
Yeah.
So every day there's something for you to do. And don't get so attached to the big things. You know, oh, we have to overrule the Supreme Court. Yeah, that'll happen. You
right.
know? But
right.
first, make sure you get a good prosecutor or judge in office.
Mm.
First, make sure you get a good city council person like Antonio Lewis down in the Cleveland Avenue sector. Mm. Make sure you get a good, you know, before our mayor was a great mayor, he was a great city council person, you know.
Right.
Those are the things you need to be doing. Hyper-local. What can I do to change the 10 houses to my left and right? And then you'll meet the other people that are doing the work. Two of the organizations I support big time, not only in terms of name, but helping people get money toward them, are Georgia Youth Build
mm-hmm.
with Christina and Randy over there. They're teaching 14 to 20-year-old kids right here in the city of Atlanta trades like electricians, carpentry, welding, things of that nature. These kids are coming out of that program earning good money and union jobs. The other one is Gary Davis's Next Level Boys Academy that helps mediate beefs, from street beefs to beefs with the parents, to help keep little boys out of 20 and 30 and 40 year sentences. Those people are hyper local. They work, and those are the ones I support. I'm not running around yelling for you to give a lot of money to national campaigns and national people, because most of the time that money doesn't make it to where it most
exactly.
needs to be.
Exactly.
Mm, representing Adamsville, the yeah. West Side. Killer Mike is here.
Mm.
This album got him feeling like Kobe when he was holding that trophy.
Come on.
You know what I mean?
Anybody who know me know I suffered slowly for years. Now I'm like Kobe gripping that trophy slowly, and I shed tears.
Come on.
You got this record with Young Thug.
Yeah, run.
And we're trying to free Young Jeffrey right now.
Yeah.
Tell us about how that record with Thug came about.
First, I'd like to see Jeffrey and Lucci free. You know,
yeah,
I'd
sure. 1,000%.
I'd like to see, I like to see when we go into the United States of America, we go into somewhere, two different factions having tumultuous times. Sometimes they free the leaders and they put them in a room, say, hey, let's figure this out, because our boys are going to be over here for the next 20 years or so stealing your resources. So let's figure out how to not let y'all kill each other. That's what we do when we go to places like Iraq, Iran, even in Jamaica in the 70s and stuff. So my thing, if you hear me say free Larry Hoover, I'm going to say free Jeff Fort too, because I think that those leaders should be free to try to help dispel some of the stuff that's going on in Chicago. And in terms of Atlanta, I think that if you look at Lucci and his guy Drew Finley, his lawyer, or you look at Jeffrey and his guy Brian Steele, I think that you put these four men in a room with a mediator, and I think things could be figured out. But in terms of rappers going to jail for simply what they're rapping, that makes me very afraid, because that means as radio personalities, you guys could say something that a politician doesn't like one day, and the next thing you know, you're being persecuted. So, you know, if actual crimes and stuff have been committed, then I can't speak to or argue that. That's for the judge and the lawyers and the jury to decide. But in terms of reading rap lyrics in court and to indict or to persecute you, I'm not a believer in that. The First Amendment should count for us. And I'll give you a perfect example. There was a white woman who wrote an article, How to Kill My Husband, and she killed her husband. And when she killed her husband, the judge did not allow her article to be used as evidence against her. The prosecutor had to figure out how to use her insurance policy and other things because, you know, she had her First Amendment rights intact. And I think that as black people, every right that you've been promised by the United States Bill of Rights and the United States Constitution, you should get before you be willing to give up.
Sure.
So before we say, oh, they rapped about this and they should lock him up, your little nephew rap, he ain't even as good, and he putting his raps on Facebook.
Come on. Yeah,
lock his black ass up.
Come on.
So you better think about it.
Seriously.
Yes, sir.
So how do you protect your peace with, you know, you being a philanthropist and going to speak to these places, and now you're going back on tour?
Yeah.
How do you protect your peace in all of this?
Oh, man, I just, I got a great wife in Shay. I have four beautiful children, and I got some cool ass baby mamas too. So, you know, I got people that care about me. I got a team, you know, I got people I'm surrounded by that make sure I'm not going too hard, because I got a habit of just going too hard. I remember waking up in the hospital one time with dehydration and exhaustion, and the doctor's just like, man, you can't spend 123 days a year on tour. You're over 40 now, sir. You know what I mean? But more than anything, man, you just have to decide to lead a peace-filled life. There's this black guy, I think his name is Moji. He's like a yogi. I'll be checking him out on YouTube. But your mind is a tool, and you'll let your tool get to overworking. You won't even know how to turn it off.
Mm-hmm.
And I just really try to get out of my mind and into the empty space that's just peace-filled, so I can actually think, you know, versus try to defend thoughts or stop thoughts and keep them at bay. But you have to decide to lead a peaceful life. When somebody bring you chaos, you got to be able to say, well, I just can't accept that. You know, you can have that one. So you cuss me out today, that's fine. You know, you needed to get it off on Twitter on a rapper, okay, that's fine. You know, but I'm in some days I get it right, some days I get it wrong. But I've decided to have a peaceful life.
For sure. So if you can go back in time and talk to young Michael, what advice would you give him?
Boy, you're going to see her. It's all going to work out. Boy, I'm talking about, boy, it's all going to work out. Boy, the cause, the fine girl with the boobs and the booty, all that, man, it's going to work out, boy. You have a big old house, man.
Right.
Your mama going to get to see it. Your grandmama going to get to see you. It's going to work out, kid. Like, dream big. Like, stay dreaming big. Even go bigger if you can. Because, you know, some of the dreams I had put in a box. But, man, I had to learn. Take it off, man. Take the ribbon off the box. Go
for
big.
Sure.
But I just, man, I put my hand on this little nappy head and say, hey, man, thank you for dreaming big. Thank you for not just being a pilot. You know,
right.
Thank you. You know, thank you, kid. He dreamed big, you know.
That's
yes,
what's
sir.
Up.
He beat the eyes like a drum.
Come
yeah.
on,
now. Some production by DJ.
That man heard the album. Y'all understand this man over here driving hits.
Come on,
man.
No, for real.
This man.
You got some production by DJ Paul.
Yeah.
Was Gangsta Boo inspired?
Yeah, man. Poop. I was looking. God bless the dead. Lola, man. My sister gone, man. Man, she, I needed. So you hear the record's very gospel, southern blues inspired. I needed that crunk. I needed that juke. I needed that Memphis, that buck. And I didn't know how to get in touch with Paul. And Boo say, man, you want me to call Paul Mike? I'm like, yeah, I got it, bro. I got it. And the next day, we're like, Paul say he gonna come through here tomorrow, man. And she made it happen, man. Like, I love that girl. I miss her so much. Yeah. She was such a, she reminds me of my mother, man. She was such a a pure soul in terms of she just wanted good for you. Mm-hmm. It didn't even have to involve. She didn't have to have a nickel in the deal. She just wanted good for you. You know what I mean? So whether it was the first time she introduced me to Drama Boy or, you know, her getting piled through the studio, Boo was just always pure. And I, mm-hmm. me and my wife both just loved her to death. You know, and I miss her dearly. But Lola, I always call her Lola, man. Yeah. Lola was special, man. I miss her. Say, man.
You hear me? Yeah. So, can you speak on Brooke Lana? You know, Run the Jewels.
Brooke Lana, man, yeah. It's me and LP, man. T-shirts coming soon, man. Yeah. Man, I just, about 11 years ago, I dropped rap music. So about 12, 13 years ago, I met LP through Jason DeMarco, who worked at the Cartoon Network. He was VP at the Cartoon Network here. He just thought we'd make good music together. He was right. I ended up making rap music, classic record, dropped 11 years ago. And then me and L started Run the Jewels and spent the next decade just building the brand of Run the Jewels and giving dope music and videos and interesting vibes and perspective. And L is the same age as me. He's a white kid that grew up in Brooklyn. I'm a black kid that grew up in Atlanta. It's as unlikely as can be, and yet here we go. And people love it. We have a cult following. They know the logo, even if sometimes they don't know the music. I see people just wearing the sweater, like it's my brother's sweater, you know? Mm-hmm. But it means a lot to me. Me and L's relationship, our music relationship, just the brotherhood and kinship we have, it means a lot, and I value it. So Brooke Lana forever, man. You know?
Yes. What is your funniest moment with CeeLo Green?
Funniest moment with CeeLo Green? Oh man, I've had a lot of moments with CeeLo. CeeLo is an extravagant guy, man. I remember CeeLo. We were in this club or something in Miami, and we were me and my girl and her partner were like stoned out of our mind, mushrooms and stuff. And CeeLo was being like very nice to this girl, like a gentleman. But she was so stoned on shrooms, she didn't realize it was CeeLo.
Yeah.
And she was like, this guy's coming on to me. We're like, no, he isn't. His girl is right next to him. That's CeeLo. He's only being nice to you. So it was pretty funny because I was like, we were zooted out of our minds, man. And CeeLo was just being a perfect gentleman. This chick thought like CeeLo's trying to get you. Like CeeLo doesn't want you, CeeLo. CeeLo. It's all good, love.
If we were to go through your iTunes playlist and your Spotify, outside of listening to yourself, what's something we would find you listening to?
Oh, man, you always gonna find me listening to some Spitta. Lately, I've been on Larry June. Shouts out to him. 2 Chainz, a lot of vintage Outkast stuff, a lot of current Big Boy. Mm. Scarface is always some Scarface, always some Sade. I rock with that. Gap Band, Commodores, what's my man? The OJs, always gonna rock some OJs. Curtis Mayfield is always there too, you know. Ballin' G, UGK, yeah, you know.
For sure.
Yes, sir. Got the H-Town connection. Tomorrow is 713 day.
Yep.
Oh, man, happy birthday to the H, man.
And I see you're going to stop the tour High and Holy in the H-Town.
Yeah, got to go to Houston.
What's that H-Town connection, you know, that you got going on?
Oh,
bro?
Man, I love Houston, man. shouts out to my man Flip. Flip was the, Flip and Hump was the, like, first guys we met from there, me and Grindtime, 50-50 Twin, all them boys, Paul and Chameleonaire, still my partners to this day. Thug and I have gotten cooler. You know, Slim Thug, real good dude. You know, rest in peace to Pokey, man. Mm-hmm. New Big Mo out there. Texas, I just always admire because Texas always just did Texas. You know, Texas, just like, you know, like Texas doesn't, they don't feel the need to be validated by others. They validate what they ride swingers. They don't care what you ride, you know what I mean?
Okay.
They ride candy paint. They don't care what you ride. You know, a DJ OG Ron C just hit me the other day, sent me a slowed down version of Scientists and Engineers jamming. Like, I love the fact that their culture, they're proud of. You know, I think if I could give anything to Atlanta, it would be like a pinch of that. Texas is so proud that even if they rock with what's going on out there, even if they change the type of fashion and stuff they wear, it's still done in a Texas way. And I think that's something that everybody can look at as an example, because I think it's important that regions have sounds.
Yes, sir.
Mm-hmm. You know, it's important that New York has a sound, that Detroit has a sound, that the Bay and LA have a sound, that Miami, Noya, Houston, Atlanta have a sound. Because all of it is black music. All of it is a black sound, you know what I mean? But we have subtle differences. Exactly. And I think those things make us cool, you know what I'm saying? And like, if you look at a place like D.C., you think of that as a North when you're from the South. But D.C. got its own thing with this go-go thing.
Yep.
And
love
what's crazy
go-go.
Is Scarface, that was one of his biggest markets. So you might have seen a Scarface show. But until you see Scarface with a go-go band, you know what I'm saying? just know that that's the beautiful thing. When you go to Houston, it's a whole different culture. And I think that people could learn that pride. I love that Texas pride. Man. Mm-hmm. I really do.
Yeah, sir. You got a pinch of Dave Chappelle on this Michael project.
Yeah, come man.
On. Where did this come from? What
that's
made
my
you
partner,
add Dave?
Man. That's my partner, man. I really rock with Dave. And he after one of his shows, he got me backstage, just cursed me out, told me to run for governor. And I was called, like, could you recreate that? You know what I'm saying? I'm like, man, I smoke weed and go to the flame. Ain't nobody going to vote for me. He was like, man, nigga, that's what I'm trying to tell you, nigga. That's why we'll vote for you, nigga, because we know who you are. You're not lying to us. And I'm just like, damn. Nigga had me at the end like, nigga, maybe I should run.
Dave, I'm up for you.
Dave is my guy. And when I run, I'm going to come up here. I'm going
to
announce.
You got to. So is there anything else that you're working on that you could tell us about?
I'm never not working on music. So, you know, I did some cool stuff out in L.A. with L. Hopefully that'll go lead us to Run the Jewels 5. I've started recording more records for whatever's next. The next Michael is going to be. But I want to march into the Grammys and come out with some trophies.
Yes, sir. You know?
Like, I think the work I put in, of it's course, 2.5-3 years is deserved. I think I tell a story that's untold, that's unheard, and that needs to be recognized. I think we should be rallying around the Michael album how we rallied around Ta-Nehisi Coates' book.
Mm-hmm.
You know, I can't wait to play Michael in the High Museum of Art, which I'm on the board of. But I want to get all us art-minded, ratchet-influenced black folks in one place to hear this in a museum because it's art. So I would expect to see me doing some cool exhibitions with people like Fahamu Paku. You know what I mean? I want to do, you know, something cool with my girl Kayla, 80 Photography. I just want to get more immersed in the art scene, and I want to march into the Grammys and walk out with some trophies, and that's just the truth. You know,
come on now.
Wow.
If you're voting for the Grammys, vote Michael.
For sure. Better believe you got my vote on that one, bro. So, I know it's a lot of bars and verses and sessions that you and Dre 3000 have had together. What's one of your favorite Dre 3000 verses?
This one, the Scientist and Engineers verse. It's quirky. Communication coming in. You know, it has a quirk about it. I like Dre. First of all, I'm one of those people, I really love my Dre and Big Boy together. There's a balance in the Outkast records that's amazing to me. So I miss that, you know what I'm saying? But with missing that, having an opportunity because Dre doesn't rap but a couple times a year, having an opportunity to have one of the verses is amazing. And we got another record that's like 11 minutes long together.
Yeah.
I think he rapped for like 7. I'm rapping for like 4 or 5 or something. We just
when
going
we gonna
crazy.
Get that?
Oh, man, let's see how the trap hammer doing, man.
Okay. Run out them streams, y'all, so we can get that 11-minute song
and
now.
Call and request that Scientists and Engineers up here. Let's get it playing.
So, hey, let's go ahead and play it right now. You want to introduce it?
Man, this is Killer Mike. Man, this is Dre 3000. This is Future, and we of the Dungeon Family. And this is Scientists and Engineers off my album Michael.
How you love that? Hey, DJ Misses.
Yes, sir.
We locked in like Rice Street without a bond.
Come on.
Hey, we talking on, to the Nissan today.
Come on.
Hey, HBCU graduate.
Come on.
I dropped out. But we working on be graduating.
Okay, then. Yeah. We claiming
her. That's why I wore mine today. I had to wear my shirt today.
Shouts out to Morehouse, man.
Man, he been leading again. This is Shay's husband.
Mm-hmm.
He's the father. Grammy Award winning artist. And if you're going to listen to anything, make sure you're listening to that Michael project.
Please.
It's an honor and a pleasure to have an official poster on the Conan Alumni Edition.
Real legend.
By the name of Killer Mike. Shooters and shooters with Rugas and shooters with Rugas CDs with my tutors and my tutors taught me a terrible mirror. You can lie, cheaters, still killing America. Be celebrated like Captain America.